Back on the season premiere of Hockey Night in Canada, second intermission means the Saturday headlines. Elliot, you could do 20 minutes on the New York Rangers, but how about a couple?
I'd love to do 20 minutes. I don't know if the audience would enjoy this much, though, Ryan. Well, first of all, the big story of the week is Shesterkin, no question about it, and the turning down of an 8x$11 million offer. And one of the things that came out of this was, does the start of the season really mean the end of negotiations? Because there had been a soft deadline on the start of the year to get this done. Well, look, I think there were some hard feelings this week that this got out, but the overall position seems to be that the Rangers believe that if they can get to a number that makes Shesterkin happy, that the start of the season doesn't mean this can't get done at some point. And that's what representatives are for, to handle all this. And I generally hear that the word is that the Rangers feel if they get to a number that he likes, they can still get it done in season. We'll see what happens. I have heard many times that Shesterkin has positioned himself as the Rangers' best player and most important player. I don't think anybody would disagree with that. And that is the target here, at least. Right now, Panarin is their highest paid player at about $11.64 million.
So is that it, if they just get above that? Because I would argue that Adam Fox, although Panarin's good tonight, by the way, Utah Hockey Club leading 5-3. Shesterkin's given up all five goals tonight. But you got Fox to consider if you're the Rangers and say, well, what about him? He's only making 9-5. And you got the Carey Price benchmark. That's always been an argument that they've made.
Yeah, there's no question that 10-5 for Carey Price. The Rangers have clearly indicated that he will be the highest paid goalie in the NHL. But that number, Panarin's number, for argument's sake, would be $1.15 million higher. And there seems to be some reticence to go there. Now, if you look at the highest paid player debate since Connor McDavid, first it was MacKinnon at $100,000 more, then Matthews at $625,000 more, then Dreisaitl at $750,000 more. It's been a thinner slicing of the onion. This would be much bigger. It's a good debate. Some people who negotiate say you never want to move that far. Others say, you know what, if the player is worth it, and there's no question Shesterkin is worth it, you just go and you make the deal.
All right, let's go to Toronto and the depth chart on defense and what happens with Timothy Liljegren.
So this has been a storyline, I think, for most of the summer. You know, he's been involved in some trade talks and the Maple Leafs have considered moving him, but it hasn't happened now. And, you know, in the preseason, he moved down the depth chart. He hasn't played yet, and Toronto is preaching patience with this. They are simply saying there's no reason he can't still play for us. However, he's a 25-year-old player. He wants to play, and there's, you know, I think he'd like to be in a position where he could play. I think at various times they've tried to work to get something done. At other times they've said, look, like, we don't like that anything's out there. And again, I think they've told him he could potentially still play for the Maple Leafs. Now, I had heard this week that he had some permission to talk to other teams. The Maple Leafs have denied that. They said that's not true, but there's no question they're trying to get him to be patient, and he's simply trying to say, look, I'd like to play as any player would.
How about injury news, starting with Macklin Celebrini?
All right, so Macklin Celebrini, unfortunately, the Sharks today put him on injured reserve. He has to miss at least 7 days, which means a showdown with Bedard next week isn't going to happen. It's believed to be a hip injury, Ron. That's the information we're getting, and he's out week to week. Also today, good news for Vancouver. It looked bad for Tyler Myers last night. They're saying lower body day-to-day, and he is going on the road trip with them. And Florida was also good news with Alexander Barkov. They said 2 to 3 weeks as the MRI showed no bone damage, which was one of the things that they were most concerned about. And finally, one other note, Ken Holland, the GM of the Edmonton Oilers last year, went to Game 7 of the Stanley Cup Final. There's been some talk about his future and what he might be up to do. I do believe one of the options on the table is a role in hockey operations in the NHL. They've spoken to him about it, think it would be a great move, but he has time to decide to see what his future will be, Ron.
A few years ago, Elliot, I said to Colin Campbell, if you had one guy in hockey you trust to get it right, either rule changes or the development or growth of the game, and
Elliot?
He said, no, he said, not you, Elliot. That's who we picked, Kenny Holland. So that wouldn't surprise whatsoever, be a great choice. Jennifer Botterill, Kelly Rudy, Kevin Bieksa, let's start with the Toronto.
Well, Matthew Nye, so for me, this is a year I think it's going to be a breakout year for Nice. Last year, you know, up and down on the top line. You know, this year he looks like he's starting on the top line and had a great playoffs. So you think, what's the next step for this guy? He's obviously one of their guys that they're developed, and they want to see him become the next Marner and Matthews. And all signs are pointing to he's bigger and he's stronger this year. He's protecting the puck a lot better. Looks like he's got a little bit more of a step. He finds the back of the net here with a nice bounce, but it all starts with him just being on the body on the forecheck. But then you're going to see this more, I think, this year. Holding on to pucks, he's another year older, another year stronger. I think he's a very tough guy to contain down low. willing to go to the dirty areas in front of the net. He's a guy that I'm watching, like, is he going to get to 60 points this year? Is he going to get to maybe 25 goals this year? Certainly, like, I think the ceiling is very high for him.
Yeah, and for Montreal and Montembeau, we're sort of doing the same thing in the pregame, projecting how good he may become. And you look at the start of the season, game one, by the way, he has perfect all 48 shots. And you look at the beginning of this, he comes out in charge of this, right? He's so confident. I love the eyes here, the focus. Going to see him in the dressing room tonight getting ready. And he's just been perfect in all 64 shots in five periods this season so far. But I just look at him and the way he plays, and I'm thinking, man, he is so fortunate to have had Carey Price for a year and then Jake Allen for a few years mentoring him. And he's just so composed and everything about him. This is exactly what Montreal needs from their goaltender.
Just before you give your Thanksgiving, what hockey's given to you, Jen, a thought on the Ottawa Senators?
Well, a thought on them, just they need to find a way, right? How important the start to this season is for them. And in that second period, a couple opportunities. They had the one power play opportunity, but finding a way to finish because they don't want to fall behind early in the season.
Thanksgiving.
I'm thankful for a lot in my career in the sport of hockey. And I certainly my teammates and friends for life. But I also think to my first hockey coach, Jill Mathey, in Winnipeg. We were the Storm. We wore turquoise jerseys. But it was a phase in my life where I was trying to decide what sport to focus on. She taught us about hard work and leadership and teamwork, but also loving the game. And I think about that often today with my three girls that are playing the game and hopefully instilling some of those same messages that Jill Mathey taught me when I first started playing hockey in Winnipeg. And I think I see that same smile through the cage that my parents talked about every time my kids hit the ice now.
As Doreen would say, why not you, Jen, right? Your mom. Okay, a short break and our coverage continues. Thank you for a lovely Thanksgiving thought. Kelly, yours is still to come as we move through the night tonight.